Professor Walters is a professor at the University of Washington in the School of Social Work. She received her MSW and PhD from the University of California, Los Angeles. She's an enrolled member of the Choctaw Nation of Oklahoma. And Professor Walters founded and directs the university-wide interdisciplinary Indigenous Wellness Research Institute. Professor Walters is also a recipient of the prestigious Fulbright Award, and she was an honorary visitor scholar at Ngā Pae o te Maramatanga at Auckland University in Aotearoa. Her research focuses on historical, social, and cultural determinants of physical and mental health among American Indians and Alaska Natives. She's published and presented nationally and internationally on her research, and she mentors numerous American Indian and Alaska Native junior faculty, researchers, postdoctorate, graduate, and undergraduate students. From a personal perspective as an Indigenous researcher who aims to use quantitative research, I'm constantly in awe of her work, where she's able to use quantitative and qualitative research methods from an Indigenous positioning. And she does that in a way that can express the lived experiences and the real effects of colonisation and the intergenerational impacts that has on our people. Your work is well known in your home country, but it's far-reaching and comes to the shores of Aotearoa, and I'd like to thank you for the immense contribution that you give. Kia ora. Please welcome Professor Walters.
Hāli tō, saha tifa te Karina Walters, me te saha tifa te hata puse kan transpoa te biti a hoio, me te chata si a hoke, me te yokoke the Kulun Okla Nations, the traditional owners of this land, yokoke Mr. Steele, Auntie Dai, and Dr. Lowitja, and Dr. Romla, and other elders who are present here. I just want to acknowledge that I'm trying to come around from the knowledge that I'm hearing that we might have a Trump presidency. So I was hoping to open up with a talk about the power of women. But clearly we still have a long ways to go, baby. So, okay. That's okay. We've been through some of these times and we've weathered. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that today. We stand in the territory of the Kulun Nations and peoples along the Sacred River that just runs right outside our door. And as Auntie Dai said, it's the River of Mists and the place of two bays. And I had a chance to speak with her the other day, and I wanted to know a little bit about the river and what the river means. It's important to us and for me, in terms of my own Choctaw relatives, to know whose territory and land I'm on. And what she shared with me was that this river is very sacred. It actually is a place of ceremony in certain areas here, especially for rites of passage. And I just wanted, it made me reflect a little bit about that today, you know, as we're sharing and exchanging knowledges at this important and sacred place and honoring the transition. And actually, she said that, you know, they've started doing the naming ceremonies, and they brought back the women's business of women's ceremonies and that rites of passage. I really want to honor that. It's really important that we do that. And it's not enough that we just, you know, share the knowledge. So when we do rites of passage, it's a knowledge transfer process, and it's an accepting of responsibility. And so, too, as we share our knowledges here, we also then have that parallel responsibility to take action in the world with the knowledge once we have that awareness that comes into our consciousness. So I'm excited to be here and share that, and thank you to the Lowitja Conference for having us here, having me here. I'm going to be sharing a lot of pictures, and just so you know, they're almost all pictures from either my territory or pictures from the Trail of Tears. My tribe is the tribe that we're all the descendants of those who survived what's known as the Trail of Tears. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that today. But one of the first poems that our tribal elders decided to publish in our language in the 1870s, this was the proverb that came out, it became a proverb that came out of this poem. And it, the poem is, Yomicha okina bachoha putake etana kia ohofo biante ya umano ke yotokoke. The breeze that ruffles the stream knows not the depth below. And I don't think it's coincidental that our ancestors chose this saying. If we think about trauma or historical trauma as the breeze, little do we know what incredible strength and resilience actually lies just right below that surface. So I wanted to, it also wasn't lost on me that they use water is the metaphor, and just thinking about that as we're near the sacred waters here. So I want us to think a little bit deeply about water as I talk about historical trauma today. Indigenous teachings teach us that water is our first medicine. The majority of our world is made up of it. The majority of our body as well is made of it. And the water that we drink today actually is the same water that touched the lips of our ancestors, only to rise to the heavens and return to the earth. And in that way, through water, we have direct connections to our ancestors every single day. So when we think about that, just as we have these deep connections with water and place, our health too has deep connections to previous generations' wellness, oppression, and life circumstances. So how we address the health of our children and how we address the health inequities that we are struggling with that we have been talking about at the conference here is really critical in thinking about these connections across time and place. So our Indigenous research imperative for building innovative and actually culturally valid health solutions to address the health gaps and inequities really has to move beyond these static models to recognize the complex interconnections of health and well-being from structural inequality and structural inequities all the way down to epigenetic memories. Literally, our bodies, our minds, our spirits are inextricably linked across time, space, in place. So I want us to keep this in mind. Health risk, then, is not because of something innate to our biology, but because of the cumulative impact of colonization and racism that we experience not only over our own lifetime, but over our ancestors' lifetimes as well. The factors making a difference are actually living under conditions of material deprivation as children and then later as adults. It's the historical trauma exposure as well as the chronic stress, violence and traumatic event exposure associated with those kinds of conditions, and then the adoption of health risk behaviors as a means to surviving these difficult circumstances. But to achieve wellness, though, is not to focus, though, on this deprivation and the struggle, not on historical trauma out of context in relation to our resiliency and strengths. It's not about adopting a victim mindset or medicalizing our understandable health struggles in the face of oppression. Rather, as I talked about earlier today, it is about our collective strength, our collective resilience, and what we decide to do with it. So when I talk about historical trauma today and then transcending that trauma, what I'm really talking about is the story of power, love, and vision. So think about it this way. What a powerful place to be. In this moment, I am my grandmother's granddaughter. In this moment, I am my granddaughter's ancestor. In this moment, I'm all of these things. So in this moment, if I care for my health and I begin to heal, I heal not only myself, but I actually heal the next seven generations. In this moment, I don't only heal the future seven generations, I also get to heal anything that's left over from previous generations that I'm still that's still embodied in me. What a powerful place to be. That is not a victim mindset at all. That's been one of the big critiques about looking at historical trauma. They think that we want this to be about a victim mindset. It's not. It's about power. Historical trauma is also a story about love. It's the vision our ancestors carried for us as they struggled beyond the confines of a trauma, as they muddled through the aftermath of any traumas, as they resisted in ways to preserve their life force. All throughout those experiences, they had love for us. And they had a vision for us to live and to carry on. My Choctaw ancestors did this as we were forced to leave our homeland, actually originally thousands of years ago. This was not the first time we encountered this kind of experience. Thousands of years ago, Choctaw and Chickasaw were brothers, and they realized that there was horrible fighting going on. They said, we can't stay here. And so they got together, and they said, well, we can't leave anybody behind. And they literally meant our bones. And they gathered all the bones of our ancestors, and they carried it on their backs They said for 40 years. I think that's a biblical influence. But for a long time, until the high priest would put a big pole in the ground, and every time it would lean forward, we'd walk in that direction, and we'd carry those bones. I mean, there's stories about how we doubled back to get the bones, because every man, woman, and child carried those bones. And so until the pole stood upright at what's now known as Nanawaya, Mississippi, and that's where we decided to claim our new homeland, that's where we took our bones of our ancestors. So that's how much they love us, right, that they carried that forward. So it's really a story about love. It's also a story of vision. Just as they held a vision for us in that way, we hold a vision for the future generations too. So we must carry forward into the next seven generations by the actions we take, whether we're health researchers, whether we're practitioners, whether we're community members just trying to scrape it together with our family and friends to get by, whatever it is, we have that responsibility and that incredible vision. We are now in the seventh generation of Choctaws since our forced removal. That's another powerful moment. We actually have an opportunity to now envision the next seven generations, starting that cycle over again. So this is where we are. So this is a story I'd like you to keep in mind as I talk about historical trauma today and health. It's about the vision of love, life, and power. We are not to be defined by collective traumas and struggles. This is really truly the mindset of the colonizer and internalized colonization. But rather, we need to be defined by our ancestral teachings, also known as our original instructions. These provide the lifeways, the protocols, the instructions for healthful living, staying in balance, being disease-free, and it provides the protocols for responsibilities to one another and to ourselves. It's the vision of love that our ancestors carried for us, and that's passed on to us since time immemorial, and that we in turn can pass on to future generations. So I was thinking about the truth and reconciliation this morning and the impact of lies and the importance of truth. And as we talk about our original instructions, I have a little brief story to share with you because I actually went back and this is how I think. I think, well, what were our original teachings about lies? I'm sure we have stories about that. And sure enough, I found one. So I know we have protocols about that. And I wanted to share it with you briefly because I think it has implications for us in our meeting here. Now, I'm going to talk about the sons. When I talk about the sons, it's spelled S-U-N-S. These were the high priests who literally were seen in the ancient times in our temples as having direct connection to the sun. They had that kind of sacred power. And the fire is really the manifestation of creator on earth. Fire is so sacred because it's the sun on earth. And so there's all of these protocols in ancient times and still to this day about once you light a sacred fire and the protocols for taking care of it and nurturing it and ensuring a certain responsibility to that fire because the people's life is tied to that fire. We're told if that fire dies and extinguishes, so do we as a people. So that's how important that fire is. So a long time ago, there were the sons of the temple. These were a hereditary line of leaders who would preside over the sacred temple and preside over the sacred fire as a way to maintain the community well-being. So the sacred fire was usually tended by two guardians at a time to ensure that it never went out. Well, one day, one guardian decided to take a break, and he walked off for a little bit saying, "I'll be right back." The other guardian said, "No problem, it's fine, go right ahead." And as he was sitting there, he started getting a little sleepy, and he fell asleep. And when he fell asleep, what happened? The fire died. Fire went out. Well, upon awakening, he was really upset about this, and he didn't know what to do. And since the other man had not returned yet, he decided to conceal his error. He asked a man passing by the temple if he would loan him a coal so he could light his pipe. But what he did is he took that coal and relit the fire, creating an impure fire. What happened after that was immediately sickness took hold of all the sun priests. They all started to die. Within days, 9 of the sun priests had died in rapid succession. It was necessary to try to quickly find other priests to fill their roles. Then the guardian who had rekindled that impure fire grew sick himself and worried about that. On his deathbed, he confessed his deed to one of the great sun chiefs. The great sun chief immediately distinguished this impure fire and had pure fire brought in from another temple from outside of our area. As soon as he returned the healthy fire to the community and the truth was told, the sun priest ceased to die, community order was restored, and once again, health was restored. So that's our teaching. And it made me think about that in terms of truth and reconciliation, the importance of not being complicit in the lies or the illusions that we're okay, that everything's fine, that it's an opportunity for us to actually speak the truth. And if we speak the truth according to our story, and there's all kinds of things, there's teachings in the story, but if we speak the truth, then we have the opportunity to really be healed. And it's really critical that we do so. We do not do a service to our people if we maintain an impure fire, if we maintain an illusion that's not healthy or well for our people. In Choctaw, we also have a saying called iyikowa. That means broken foot. That's the literal translation. But what it really means is the value of collective action to serve the needs of somebody else who's struggling. So if someone was sick or someone needed their house, fixed, the whole community would come together to ensure that that person's health and well-being was restored. So I want to keep that in mind as we talk today. So all of us have these teachings. All of us have the original instructions to identify ways to return health and well-being to our communities. And I'm going to share a little bit about how we did that in our study. Now, I've been talking about historical trauma. I am not going to go on and on about it. I'm going to just say a couple of key points about it. Historical trauma, I spent a good deal of my early, a huge part of my career having to say historical trauma is a real phenomenon that has an impact on us, and spending all that quantitative and qualitative time to demonstrate that. Mostly because when I went for my first grant at the National Institute of Health, when I used the word historical trauma and colonization, I got feedback from the reviewers that there's no evidence that historical trauma or colonization has negatively impacted people. Where do you begin with that? So I made it my career mission to begin to gather that evidence, and I will share just a little piece of that with you. But I'm at a new phase in my life and my career, and I'm at the point where our communities are saying, okay, we know it. Now how do we transcend it? How do we move beyond? How do we create interventions to really address this? And that's the part I want to really share with you today, that I'm really excited to share with you about a project near and dear to my heart with my own community, my own people. But first, we all want to make sure we're on the same page about words. When I'm talking about historical trauma, it's not the same as intergenerational trauma. Intergenerational trauma could be a natural disaster, a massive flood that wipes out a community. That would be a trauma that could persist for generations. But when I'm talking about historical trauma, I'm talking about traumatic events that are designed by human beings to commit genocide, or another form of genocide called ethnocide, which is the attempt to do systematic destruction of culture and life ways. Okay, the intention is to do that. That's historical trauma. That's not the same as, it's parallel to intergenerational trauma, but it's very different when the intent is to kill a people or their life ways, yeah? And then there's a third element, epistemicide. Eradicate our great systems of thought and knowledge, or appropriate it and change it around. That's a whole nother conversation, okay. Boarding school, I know there was boarding school impact here, boarding school impact back with us in the 1880s. The federal government determined that we are finally half a human, a little bit more than maybe half a human, so therefore we are teachable. If we are teachable, then we can get rid of the Indian to save the man. General Pratt, who was put in charge of Indian boarding schools, where they stole children from homes and put them in these schools. We're talking about hundreds of thousands of children. And this happened in Canada as well. The whole intention behind that was, as General Pratt said, to kill the Indian to save the man. All right, so in these schools, children were not parented. They were parented by a militarized system. They were exposed to discipline that included harsh punishment, and they were exposed to really high rates of sexual assault in these schools. So it was bad all the way around. But that's an example of some of these historically traumatic events in the 1880s. This is Carlisle Indian School, one of the first massive schools to employ this. This is Tom Torino, a young Navajo man when he first arrived at Carlisle, and this is him 3 years later. Okay, this is our Choctaw boys track team at one of the schools. I just wanted to show you because I think they're pretty good looking. Got to use a little humor, right? Sometimes this gets very heavy. Here's some of your young Choctaw men, young boys who were put into boarding schools. And just to give you an idea, I mean, these are babies, yeah? Very young children. I want to also point out, you notice all their hair is cut off. And there's a lot of problems because Native kids died from homesickness in these schools. Some of them thought their parents had been killed because in some tribes, if you cut your hair, it's a sign of mourning. That means their death has occurred. So when they were taken to these schools and didn't know where their parents were and didn't have contact with their parents, they thought that their parents had died in some cases. So it was pretty horrible. These Choctaw girls at Wheelock Academy. I'm going to focus on Choctaw women in a minute. This is post-removal. So the other ugly part, this is, you know, we were talking about, you know, the impure fire. So I have to talk about a little bit of our dirty laundry, too. Part of the role of colonization is to get us to do the work of the colonizer. And that's called, we talk about that as internalized oppression. But it's very dangerous, yes. This is actually one of my relatives, Chief David Folsom. He started a paper called the Choctaw Telegraph that was focused on improving the moral standing of Choctaws once we were removed to Indian territory. And in that, he had a series of articles, and I'm not kidding you, I started looking into this, I want to write an article on it, about the proper etiquette for Choctaw women to fit in properly in Western society. Literally changing the matrilineal, matriarchal position of power for our women. I'm not saying he had that responsibility, but that was, you know, our leaders started buying into that, and that was problematic. That's one of the fires we got to deal with. Our artists write about this and paint about it. So here's some of the work of Karen Clarkson. So this is still having an impact in our communities. And so what is the impact of historical trauma? There's all kinds of impact, and we've been hearing about it a lot the last several days. But I want to highlight a couple that I think are things I want us to always remember. One is it causes the disruption. It really is designed to disrupt our ability to fulfill our original instructions. When General Sheridan said, go kill the buffalo to kill the Lakota, he wasn't talking about just interrupting their food and access to food. He was talking about interrupting a people's ability to fulfill their original instructions. It was a direct spiritual assault. That's an important piece here. Historical trauma is about a spiritual assault. It's not just about the assault on body and land. It's bigger than that. It also is a disruption. It causes, its intent is to disrupt our relational ways of being. When you remove children and put them in boarding schools like that, it disrupts their ability to have relational understanding of the world around their parents, their gender roles, who they are in the world, who they're meant to be in the world. That's a relational way of thinking, okay? It causes a disruption in our spatial obligations and relationships. You begin to, you know, have to be in survival mode. You're not thinking about having an impact seven generations down the road. And of course, that leads to breakdown of boundaries. A related piece to this is the point of colonization is to create systems of dependency. So we could see this get played out in healthcare systems a lot, right? On the extreme end, if we internalize it. We basically socialize the Western science and mainstream medicine tries to socialize people to be good patients. Part of being a good patient is recognizing your disease state and in some ways internalizing it. So a way to think about that in terms of the states of issues that and problems that our communities disproportionately face, whether it's alcoholism, substance abuse, obesity, diabetes. In all of those cases, if a person comes in, and I remember Dr. Eduardo Duran sharing this story once with me, and I'll share it with you. You know, he had a patient come in once and said, the patient said, oh, I'm here to see you. And he said, oh, good, you know, tell me a little bit about yourself. Who are you? And that patient said, because they've been in that system a long time, oh, I'm depressed. So Ed said, okay, is that what your mother named you, depressed? Is that how I should call you, you know? And the client's like, are you crazy? What are you talking about? He's like, no, you just told me you received the name Depressed. Tell me about the naming ceremony that you went through to receive this name Depressed. It's very important to know these things. Now, why is he doing that? He's doing that because it's starting to thinking, transforming the way we think about it, right? All of a sudden, you've received a name. Now, naming, Auntie Di talked about this, bringing back the naming ceremonies. Naming is incredibly powerful for our people. Naming provides the protocols by which we conduct ourselves in the world. It provides the protocols in which the community understands the relationships to us. It provides a guide for our behavior in the world. So Ed said, rightfully so, tell me about your naming ceremony. Meanwhile, the client's going, what are you talking about, naming ceremony? He said, you know that one where they come in, there's a group of people, usually social workers and psychologists, and maybe psychiatrists, and they come in and they wear their special suits and they sit and they pull out this very sacred book. And they open up that book and they all gather around it and they all have this big conversation. And then they finally go, yeah, this is, should be his name, he is depressed. It's that DSM book, you know. Meanwhile, the client's thinking, this guy's really off of his rocker. And then he's going to shift it again, putting Indigenous thought into it. These are the colonizing practices that we want us to think about and how this translates to our research. Then he'll say, well, tell me a little bit about this relationship to this depression that you have. Now you have a relationship, you're not the disease, right? Why is it we're diabetic, we're alcoholic, we become our disease? But if you have cancer, you know what? You don't say I'm cancer unless you know that's your sign, your zodiac sign. So he says, now we're not going to have you be the disease. Instead, we want to understand your relationship to this thing called depression. Tell me, when does it visit you? It's like, what do you mean? Does it wake you up? Does it get you up at 3 o'clock in the morning? When does this depression visit you? So you start shifting the language, all of a sudden it's not inside of the person all the time, but rather you have a relationship, and if you have a relationship, what can you do? You can break up. You can set boundaries, and that's part of the decolonizing process, is beginning to reconnect to our boundaries and boundary settings. So that's just an example of some of the ways, at least in these systems, that we begin to unpack it and look at the historical trauma impact, and then look at decolonizing approaches to do it. So that involves three elements, right? Always thinking about what are our original instructions about these things? How do we restore relational ways of being, right? What is your relationship to this depression as opposed to being depressed? And narrative transformation, because really how we talk our story really does matter. So I'm going to share a little bit about how we did that in one of my projects here. Oh, and I just should say, there is empirical evidence for this. Sometimes we are told that we're being ideological or too emotive, as Moana Jackson said the other day, if we get passionate about these things. But I have done some research, and just to give you a quick little glimpse of it, basically after we control, you know, the big debate is it the contemporary violence you've been exposed to, or is it the past violence that really matters? I think that's a red herring. I think it's actually how do these two processes potentially interact together to produce the health and resistance that we currently have now, and resilience. So basically, in our main analyses, after we controlled for lifetime physical abuse, sexual abuse, military service, as well as people's own historical trauma event exposure, so that we isolated either their parents, their great-grandparents, all the way up to three generations back, we wanted to see if the chronicity of those kinds of events in previous generations would impact their mental health and substance use in the present generation. And basically what we found is it did. That after controlling for all of those things, the overall trauma, historical trauma events across generations was associated with elevated PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, in this current generation. It was also associated with alcohol-related problems in the past year, cocaine use and stimulant use as well. So there is some data for it. And there's a little example. And the chronicity of these kind of patterns were flatter profiles. So the chronic trauma through generations was associated with overall poor mental health in the present generation. We see this pattern across the data. Okay, so how do we translate this now into research action? And one of the things that we do in all of our research is, now, moving from historical trauma to transcending historical trauma, we think about how do we build interventions that incorporate those three elements, the original instructions, relational restoration, and narrative transformation. I like this picture. This is also a picture done by a Choctaw artist that kind of made me think about how, you know, Indians were on the moon first, and then the Western science caught up with us, yeah. We're already in space exploration. Do you guys have stories like that? Okay. So to do this, it involves a paradigm shift, and to kind of start really thinking about how pernicious historical trauma is in our thinking, I want to give you an example. Crabs in the bucket. Right? You all know that? Do you guys have that saying here? You know, the idea is crabs in the bucket. When there's crabs in the bucket, and you put them in a bucket, if another crab tries to crawl out, you pull them back down. It's sometimes used as a metaphor for lateral violence, that as soon as one of us starts to do well, we're going to pull each other down. And it starts to look like it's natural behavior of crabs, that they do this kind of horrible stuff to each other. You know, and of course, if I'm a social worker crab in the bucket, because I'm social work, I would be in there like, how do you feel? What's happening? If we can only just like mobilize and get together, we can all lift each other up. And then we'd have the therapist in there saying, you know, put some, you know, you can't be, you know, using that claw against that person over there. That's not nice, you know. All right, so let's think about this for a minute. Crabs don't live in buckets. Buckets are not natural to crabs, folks, right? Crabs don't live in buckets. We almost accept this as a metaphor for human behavior, especially in our communities. But we don't live in buckets. Crabs don't live in buckets. Natural crab behavior. What is natural crab behavior? You know, they could be ornery with each other, but natural crab behavior is living on rocks with each other. Natural crab behavior, for some crabs, they actually pull each other up on rocks when they live naturally in the ocean. Living in a bucket is not natural to crabs. So I want, you're like, what is she talking about? The idea is that, listen, we take for granted, in some ways we're even socialized to think about ourselves as being crabs in the bucket. But what we forget is to look at the bucket. And part of our work is to dismantle the bucket to get back to our natural state, because that is not natural for us to be pulling each other down. That is not natural at all. And so it's that bucket part that we need to get rid of and start to challenge. And that's true for our paradigms, our theories, our practices. You know, how often are there buckets there and we're not even paying attention to it? So, okay, you'll take that home. You'll be, okay, crabs in the bucket. Let me think about that. Okay, I just saw this beautiful picture of the river here and I wanted to share it. That was all. So on to the work that we have done with my tribe. I'm really excited to share this with you. I want to acknowledge Dr. Johnson Jennings. She's another Choctaw researcher who's involved in this project as a co-PI with me. Sandy Stroud, who's the project director. Carrie Harrod, who began this with us, and all the other Choctaw women. It's an unusual project. It's all Choctaw run. From the PhDs all the way down to the community. All Choctaw run. Highly unusual, right? It makes it really exciting. Just a little bit about my people. You know, we actually descend from the mound builders in North America, the ancient cities that were there. This is Cahokia. 40,000 people used to live in Cahokia thousands of years ago. It was a great place of agricultural trade. We descend from these folks. Corn, beans, and squash was our main source of agriculture. You know, when people talk to me, I do urban Indian research too, and they're like, oh, what's it like being in the cities? It must be so hard for you. And I'm like, we already been in cities. It's just living under the conditions of colonization that makes it tough. Okay. Trump got me a little wired here, so yeah. These are traditional mounds. This is Nanawaya. We have our origin stories from there. And again, here's some of my ancestors acknowledging to my generation. We also descend from the people who, when we lived in Mississippi in 1830, Andrew Jackson, the president at the time, he's the one who made the decision to remove us. Although I have to say, he's not the first one to think of it. Thomas Jefferson actually was the one who first thought of it. But Andrew Jackson actually went on about it. And we were removed from the, according to the Treaty of Dancing Rabbit Creek. That's why I have a rabbit. And the story that we've been sold is that we were those kind of the sellouts that agreed to sign off on this treaty and trade our lands to remove to Indian territory. And that's actually not the story at all. It was over 3 days of our people saying, no, we refuse to accept this treaty. And actually, there's a part of the story that's really important because I'm going to start talking about the power of women. We're a matrilineal matriarchal culture and historically. And our women actually, there were 7 chairs. After the men had their discussion, all the chiefs from the different villages came together to have the discussion about the treaty. They put out 7 chairs in the center of the arbor, and it was the women who had the final say. And the women said, no, we don't accept this. And then people started to leave. And then the military moved in and said, no, we want you to reconsider. That happened over 3 days. People were given over $2,000 worth of alcohol during the 3 days. And what ended up happening was on the third day, we still said no. And at that point, the guns came out. And we were forced to sign at that point. So these are the other stories that don't make it into the history books. But what ended up happening was Article 14 of the treaty says, and this is the reason why our chiefs rejected the treaty also, basically said, if we stay in Mississippi, we will be unharmed, but we would have to give up our rights to being Choctaw. So we can stay as individual citizens of Mississippi. And our chief said, all of our, and our women said, absolutely not. We'd sooner die or perish than give up our right to who we are. Now, that's important for me to know as a Choctaw in this day and age, that this was the vision that they had for us. Now, these are the stories we're told, but there's actually some evidence to that, and I'm going to share a little bit. This project actually allowed us to dig out some of this evidence. Just to give you a background here, this is where we are originally from, this area here. And then we had to walk and we're moved to this is our territory now. And we were the first of the tribes to be removed. Cherokees get all the credit, but we were actually the first. So that's our traditional lands there. We got moved to there, the southeastern part of what's now Oklahoma. Those of you who don't know, Oklahoma is actually a Choctaw word. It means red people. We actually still use our traditional names. And we have districts assigned according to our own traditional, so the power of naming, we still have that in place for that district. So you can see that you'll see here there's Mushlatabi, Apukshanabi, and Pashmataha, these three big names. Those are our main chiefs during that period. So, and really they represent different clans or large family groups. And the project I'm going to talk about with my own tribe involves working with women across all of these districts. So I'll share a little bit about that. Oops. Okay, and a little bit, this is an entrance into our territory. You see the Kaimichi Mountains there. So in 2011, the Choctaw Director of Health Services, Mickey Percy, had approached me and asked if there's a way I could possibly help them with some obesity prevention work there, and among other health issues and how they're all related. And I actually went and toured a lot of our facilities there. And I have to tell you, we have amazing gyms. We have beautiful gyms, state-of-the-art gyms to work out in. We have our tribes putting in walking paths. They've done everything that you're supposed to do, from the structural all the way down to the behavioral. Changed the menus at our hospitals and our health places, our community centers. They've done all of these things. And so Mickey pulled me aside and he asked if I could help. And I said, well, what's the extent of the problem? And he said, well, 70% of our people are living with obesity. 1 out of 3 of our Choctaw children by 2050 will have type 2 diabetes. That's the projection right now. That's horrible. And this is what really got me is he said, what I'm looking at is in my lifetime, I'm going to see parents outlive their children. And he said, and I want to stop this train. And I said, well, what have we been doing? And so he went through the whole list. Our tribe has done great, great work on importing Western science and Western approaches and adapting it to Choctaw ways. I mean, we've done a lot of that. And again, from the behavioral health end all the way up through structural changes. And I said, you know, we've got all these state-of-the-art things going on. What's the impact? And it's been very slow, a little bit steady, but so far only 3% change with millions of dollars spent. And I said, what's going on? And he said, well,
30% of the people who are seeking services are just getting fitter. It's the 70% who still don't come in. And I said, well, what do you think is making it hard for people to come through that door? And he said, it's a sadness that I can't put my finger on. And he, anyway, so he said, can you help us? So I walked away. I thought, oh my gosh, how am I going to do that? I mean, that's a tall order. And I actually said, it's not about a lit review anymore. Now I have to go pray, because it was really about prayer at that point. I had to think about some kind of inspiration, if there's a way that I can maybe help. And I walked away, and it was really simple that it came to me. And this is when the script and everything started to shift for me about transcending historical trauma. I realized that our ancestors did not walk that trail of tears for us to be dying the way we're dying. That they walked that trail with a vision of love and life for us, and that we have an obligation, a responsibility to recommit to that vision of living and life for our current generation and future generations. And it's as simple as that. And so I went back and I met with Sharon Fleming, the chief sister at the time. And Sharon had this really neat idea about, she'd been thinking about looking at traditional medicine plants and other things on the trail and getting women out on the trail. And so she and I got together, Mickey asked us to work together on this, and we came up with a crazy idea, which was, you know, all these Western approaches are not working by tagging a feather on it. And so what we need to do is come up with our own Choctaw-specific health promotion model from a Choctaw point of view, and then look at what Western models we could tag on. Kind of flip the script. And so we proposed to rewalk the Trail of Tears for 10 days in order to develop a Choctaw-specific health promotion model, that by retracing the steps of our ancestors, we would somehow begin to realize the vision that they had for us and create a model based on that. And that sounds a little crazy. And we went to and proposed it, and I thought for sure Mickey would throw us out of the trailer when we met with him. And instead, he looked at me and he said, go do it. You're in charge. I was like, and he said, I want you to do it in 9 months, in less than like 8 months. I want you to do it in the middle of June. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with June and walking through Mississippi, Arkansas, and Oklahoma during June, I don't know what that temperature would be in centigrade, but it's like 100 degrees. So it's incredibly hot. But we realized we had to approach this in a decolonizing way. And so what Sharon and I, and Michelle Johnson Jennings was with us there for this conversation as well, and she was also jumped on board and got excited about this. And we said, we have to approach this differently, and we have to even decolonize ourselves sometimes. So Mickey said, this is a great idea. Take some of the youth with you, and you know, you can talk about substance abuse prevention, you could talk about HIV/AIDS prevention, you could talk about all these things on the trial. And we said, no, that's what we don't want to do. He's like, what do you mean? I said, what we want to do is we want to wake up in the morning and we say our prayers and we're going to look up and we're going to say, what can our ancestors teach us today instead of substance abuse about our original teachings about medicines? And if we get out of balance with those medicines, how do we correct it? Instead of psychopathology, we want to say, what can our original teachings teach us about staying healthy and well and in balance? But if we get out of balance, what's our corrective action? Instead of suicide prevention, what are our original teachings about life and living? So flipping the script was really critical to developing, for us, a Choctaw health promotion model. And we were trusting that literally walking in the steps of our ancestors, we would do this. Now, we got support from the community. We had traditional elders step up and tell us how to prepare ourselves. We had no idea who was going to volunteer to do this with us, because it was a pilot to try to develop this. And you know who stepped forward in all of this? Oh, I'm sorry, one last thing I want to say. The other thing that was different about this is we said we want to create an intervention that is not about services. We have spent too much time about creating our wellness in systems of services. They're important. I'm not taking away from that. They're critical. They help us. But we've become dependent on services to be cultural spaces for us. And so what we said, what we need to do is create an intervention that will be truly community sustainable. That's about altering our way of relating and being in the world, and it's not dependent on services, but interdependent on each other. Yeah, so. No tall order, but that's what we wanted to do. And so that's what we set out to do. And that doesn't involve, in the long run, money. It involves an investment in our community and each other. So we set out to, we figured we could do this in 10 days, because there's no way we could take 6 months off to rewalk the trail fully. And what we did is we identified, and I went through, this was really amazing research. I got to go through archival journals of military diaries. I looked up maps, in the 1800s, the old military maps of the old roads that were used. And we used GIS to superimpose those maps to find our trail. We were convinced that we needed to walk the trail. We didn't care if it took us to some bizarre place downtown and you know, barring stepping on a freeway, we just didn't want to walk there. But what we decided to do is we would walk the same amount of miles our ancestors did on average every day. So we planned to walk 8 to 10 miles, in some cases 15 miles a day, on intact portions of the trail that we could find. And then we would camp out in places where we know our clans stayed. And that took us to very strange places. It took us to wildlife refuges. It took us to the University of Arkansas and the southern part of the campus, where the trail walks right through there. the wildlife refuges were a little bit rough because there's lots of swamp creatures and bugs and alligators and things, but it made it interesting. This is Michelle and Sandy. And so we did this. We went out there, and we prepared well for it. And I'm going to talk a little bit about how we prepared for trying to develop our health promotion model. You know how we talk about community-based participatory research? And this truly is, right? It's truly research is me-search in this situation. But we also, Patricia Gonzalez said, what you're really doing is ceremonially-based practice research. We actually met with the elders. We spiritually prepared for this. It wasn't just a matter of researchers just saying, oh, we're just going to go get this information and go do it. We actually had to do a certain form of protocols to prepare for it. But our main question was very simple to start with. What is the road to Choctaw health? What does that look like? By the way, we didn't stay in cabins or anything at that time. We literally stayed out on the ground like our ancestors did. Now, who came forward to do this? We made this voluntary. And guess who stepped forward? Women. All the women did. And at first we were worried, oh, we need the men to be there. But you know what the elders told us? No. And see, what's really neat when you do the culturally based research like this, the stories come out. The stories really reveal themselves. And all of a sudden these elders were telling us these stories, and they said, listen, of course the women come forward. Don't you know that in old times that it was the women's ceremonies that restored the balance when great trauma happened to our people? You were responsible for the returning of the balance. So of course the women are going to go and do this first. We didn't know those stories. That's what started coming out. Then we heard stories about how people on the trail itself actually crushed bones of their ancestors and sewed those ancestral bones into their hems of their skirts while they went on that trail. Those are the stories that emerged. So we basically were supported and thinking about our roles as Choctaw women, and it started at this point in developing the intervention. So it became women-led, and it was culturally sanctioned. We allowed women to take their children, but you had to be over the age of 12 because you had to be in a certain amount of weight because you had to be able to survive rattlesnake bite or a water moccasin bite if you're out there on the trail. This is a whole new meaning to IRB, Institutional Review Board. We kept journals. We triangulated the data. That included dreams, archival research, GIS, all that kinds of stuff, as well as qualitative data. We actually collected data on the women who went, including ourselves. We had people interview myself and others as well as part of that data, before we went and after we went. We incorporated Choctaw principles from the very beginning. It's critical when you do this work that you start from the cultural place, but you have to identify what initial protocols you're going to enact with each other in doing this work. And this is just an example of some of the ones that we came up with. And I want to tell you the power of doing this and talking to first language speakers and how important that is. Because the word haklo, You know, typical, this is what happens in the United States. If you say to, in our tribal communities, I say, I want the word in Choctaw for listening. And they said, okay, go to our language department. You go to the language department. The word is Hoklo. I'm like, okay, the Hoklo means to listen. Yes, that's the word. So if I stop there, I'd miss something very important about Hoklo. So what we did is, once the language department said, it's Hoklo, we went back to the grandmothers, first language speakers, and we said, Grandma, what is Hoklo? And this is what Dorothy Mashaya said. These are her words. Well, Hoklo is what is said may be very important to your life. Listen, Hoklo is to remember that the medicine given to us is still out there. We have just forgotten to listen to it for it. It is to be at peace with oneself, to be quiet and soft in spirit, to stop trying to outspeak others, to hear and communicate, to understand. It is about sharing from the spirit and taking the time to honor another human being. That's Hoklo. So it's important to get to that level, that almost spiritual level of it. Again, we did our preparations. We had medicine instructions, even how to take care of ourselves on the trail. Let me tell you, just because we're all Choctaws walking on the trail doesn't mean we're all in the same place culturally, right? And so some of our younger people were like, I'm not going to be doing some of that stuff, and they regretted it later. There was some practical reasons why. For example, we had to create cedar water, and we were instructed by the elders to wash our legs down every night and our feet after walking the trail. Spiritual reasons to clean yourself. There's practical reasons, too, called chiggers and ticks and other kinds of ugly bugs. So the ones who did it didn't get it quite as bad as the ones who didn't do it. So we got to listen to those elders. We also approached the trail as the sacrifice of giving back. And we weren't approaching the trail as about getting caught up in the drama of the trauma. This wasn't about getting into a memorial moment and sitting with the awful stuff of our ancestors. It was about, again, reconnecting to that love and that vision. But also recognizing that culturally, you can't ask for something without giving something. It's a give and take process, right? And even if you ask for something, you might not receive it. Culture, knowledge isn't earned necessarily until the time is right. And so we recognize we might not get what we were looking for, but we had to be willing to put ourselves out there to get it. So every day we reflected, every day we met, and we would have talking circles and things like that. We also did digital stories and we blogged our experience. And the reason we did that is we wanted people who couldn't be with us to follow along with us. We thought that was important. So we ended up with 13 Choctaw walkers, 5 Native women allies to bear witness. One was an international Indigenous woman who was bearing witness, and 3 non-Native allies. We started with a rough curriculum of ideas of things that we wanted to explore each day, and we made sure we had Choctaw words related to that curriculum every single day that we would actually use. So this is us starting on the trail. And this is, we started. Now, it was interesting. This is an identity process. We talk about strength, knowledge, and identity for this conference. We thought, we kind of had this fantasy that we'd all want to go back and start in Mississippi and walk over. But instead, what ended up happening is we realized, no, we're Oklahoma Choctaw now. We actually want to start in Oklahoma. We need to start there to start the process, and that's what we did. It was hot, over 100 degrees. We had lots of bug bites. You can see poor Ramona at the bottom there. She's looking pretty annoyed. It's very hot that day. And like any group process, it's hard. Here's some of the parent-child pairs that went. Very important to see that experience. This is an example of the trail. This is one of the intact portions of the trail. This is not eroded that way because of erosion. It's from the walking. We're not the only tribe that went through this part of the trail. All of the other tribes did, a lot of them did as well. So you could see how deep the erosion is from all of the walking. Swampy. Didn't realize how swampy Arkansas was until we started walking through it. Swampy. You hear screams at night with the snakes and stuff. We got flooded one night, but that's, you know, the least of our problems compared to our ancestors. It's in swamps like this that I descend from the ancestors. We were able to find our actual clan relationships, and I know my own family's trails. And one of the incompetent agents, when they removed us, walked us through one of these swamps, and we walked for 30 days in waist-high water in the swamps. And we have stories about how women lost their children. They died, and they refused to leave them there, so they carried them on their backs through that swamp. That's who we come from. We had some microaggression encounters in Arkansas, needless to say, not surprising. The other thing that we discovered is laughter is medicine and how important laughter is to us. It made us even start reflecting on, you know, are we just like, you know, are all Indigenous people just funny and think things are funny? And then we realized, no, Choctaws, we're particularly irreverent. We're kind of known for that. We'll be at a funeral, we'll be laughing, and they'll be like, oh, those Choctaws, you know. And we realize that laughter is our medicine. And the other thing that we import, the powerful thing about being on this trail was realizing our ancestors didn't stay in the drama the whole time. They actually made babies on this trail, right? There is something, you know, being there, you realize that people carried on. And that was really important in terms of transcending trauma, that people continue to live despite this horrible circumstance. So laughter is medicine. So it made us look back even to our language. Our word for welcome is ayokpanchi. You know what that means? Welcome to the place of laughter. Who knew? So laughter is medicine. We brought our young people, the importance of having young people on this this trip. So what we ended up doing is creating from this, two pilot studies that we did to start creating a curriculum. And I'm going to share a little bit about that curriculum, then I'm going to wrap it up. But what we decided to do is we applied for a grant and we ended up getting it, basically saying, you know, our tribe started off with, can you help us fix obesity and substance abuse? These are the two big issues. And we said, sure, we'll write a grant to do that. But now that we have a Choctaw-specific health model, which I'm about to share with you, one of the things that is important to us is we're not going to make it about, you know, it's not going to be an obesity, we're not going to say, oh, can you sign up for our obesity prevention and substance abuse prevention project? Because no one's going to come. Instead, we said, what we want to do is create Choctaw health leaders. If we want a sustainable program, and it's not a program or a service, if we want a sustainable practice in our community, then we have to have Choctaw women step up and reassert their rights as Choctaw women in their roles to the community. And then doing that, we decided what we wanted to target was to create 150 Choctaw women health leaders across Choctaw Nation by the end of this project, that they would be there for each other. And so that's what we did. We developed our Choctaw-specific model, but I'm just sharing with you a little bit of the incorporation of a Western approach, which is the Information Motivation Behavior Model, IMB. And, you know, Western science says if you give someone a little bit of information, that should motivate them to change, right? We know that really doesn't work that well in general. But we said, but what will motivate people to change is if we do it in a cultural, deep cultural framework of the original instructions, and then people then become motivated because they understand their relational way of being in the world. And we made that argument. And then we also incorporated behavioral skills and other knowledge that we know from Western science about triggers and other kinds of things that can happen, about overeating and other things. That was also brought in, but the foundation was always our Choctaw thought. So the model that we came with up with from being on that trail is this one. I'll share with you briefly. We realized the power of our clans, and we were told our clans stopped existing, which, by the way, should never have happened, because no mother or grandmother would ever let their child not be associated with something. That should never have happened. The idea that we can't even have clans anymore because of this matrilineal certain kind of system with, you know, through the women's line. Well, the reality is our grandmothers would never have let anyone go unchecked in the community. They would have dreamt a clan for that person if they had to, right? So we started really going back to our elders saying, well, we have this idea about the clans. Can we draw from our clans to create health societies and learn from the protocols that were tied to those clans? Can we incorporate that into a model of behavioral change for the individual, that they will look to those clans to guide their everyday behavior? And our elders said, go do it then. You know, enough talking to us, just go do it. And we're like, okay. And so that's what we did, is we started building these clans and looking to the clans to help us understand how that impacts our contemporary behavior today. So these women the idea is that these are women who say, I want to change, I want to step up for my community, to be a health leader for my community. I recognize I got to start with myself. I'm willing to make that change myself. And that actually happened on the early pilot work. Our colleague Carrie Harrod, the behavioral health director, went on the project. She said, I have to do this first before I can ask anyone else to do it. She's lost 65 pounds and have kept it off for 3 years from that experience. Sandy Stroud has lost close to that as well. I mean, there's something about that these women are saying is transformative. And so out of that, we created this model. So the idea is, the Kowi, the panther, that's our warrior society. And when you have a warrior society, it's not just about fighting, but it's about being able to read the enemy and read the signs. So we talk about that in terms of reading your triggers, reading your signs. So there's all kinds of ways we kind of go back and forth with the Western and our Choctaw thought. Then what we said is, after you complete that two-month curriculum and the work we do it together, we do 30 women at a time. Here's the 30 women at a time. It's a step wedge design. We do 30 women at a time, and then afterwards, they do a vow-making ceremony by rewalking the trail for 10 days. And in that 10 days, they're making a commitment to what clan they're going to be and what they're thinking about. And over the course of the year, we give them a little bit of money so they do a prevention event at their community level. And then at the end, we do digital stories, and then we do a big naming ceremony and a community recognition ceremony as the leaders of their community. And so the idea is, if we have an overdose in one community, the White Crane clan normally would have taken care of that because they're responsible for the transitions to the other side. So all the White Crane women, the White Crane women in that one community would call all the other White Crane women and ask them for help to come for prevention at that local community to prevent any other substance overdose happening. So that's what we're doing. The three main questions that guide this project right now, remember I started off as, what is the Choctaw Road to Health? The questions we use now is, what kind of ancestor did my ancestors envision me to be? This is what we ask the women. So the whole curriculum is about, first part of it's asking that question. Second part of it is, what kind of ancestor do I want to be by the behaviors I engage in their everyday life? And the third question is, what kind of ancestor do I want or envision future generations to be by the actions I'm taking today? Because that has that direct connection. It's too long to go into, but the importance of being out on the land and the experiential outdoor aspects of this is very powerful. Songs came to us. The rest of our Choctaw Trail of Tears came. The song, that our ancestors sang when we crossed the river, the Mississippi, Mishapasapokmi, when we crossed the Mississippi, when we left our ancestors on the other side, when they saw us go to the other side, they cried for us. And they sang the song, Hina Hushi Pisali, Bochito Onali, Ya Yali, Ya Yali. When I see you cross that river, I cry. That's all we have left of that song. That's the song that we know. But what came to us is the rest of the song on that trip that we can pass on to our children. So now we've got this project going. We finished our first two cohorts. We're in the middle of our second cohort right now, and we're really seeing, anecdotally, some really neat things are starting to emerge. And then I can't show you the women's faces, but this is one of our groups walking. And so, in summary, I just want to close. The Native youth once said to her elder, she goes, oh, I'm so lost. We've lost everything. We've lost our language. We've lost our land. We've lost this. We've lost that. And I remember I witnessed this. This Alaska Native elder turned to her and she said, darling, it's you who are lost. So as long as we have the land, as long as we have the trees, as long as we have our water, as long as we have the air, the answers are there for us. Linda Hogan, a Chickasaw poet, said, it is not that we have lost the old ways and intelligences, but that we are lost from them. They are always here, patient, waiting for our return to their beauty. Until we do, we all have restless spirits. So just circling back to the water in closing, that relational orientation to water and our ancestors. That boundary is permeable, it's fluid. But if we don't care for it now, We're not caring for our bodies or our future generations. So we must grow those truly relational practices because we are all related, yeah? Also, our diversity is our strength, our diversity of thought as Indigenous people. You know, we may share the same agenda regarding our justice, our liberation, our health equity, but we have different strategies. We may have shared the same sky, but we have different cosmologies. But our diversity is our strength, and our common fight is our glue. And our liberation is really intimately tied to each other. So thank you, Lowitja, for bringing us together. And our potential for deep humanity in fighting these multiple oppressive structures and creating these innovative, culturally grounded health solutions is all in our hands. You know, Desmond Tutu once said, upon reflecting on his Truth and Reconciliation hearings, he said, "It was not human evil or recognition of the immense depth of depravity and suffering that humans impose on one another that most profoundly moved him. He said it was the fact that human beings could be so good, that human beings could demonstrate such extraordinary magnanimity and nobility of spirit, that human beings can, after excruciating suffering, and still be able to, in fact, speak words of healing or words of forgiveness to one another. That's what so deeply moved him. It is in the spirit of compassion that our healing journey actually begins and health equity can be achieved." You know, Moana Jackson reminds us the importance of our passion, yeah? I'm feeling very passionate with Trump these days right now. But I want us to remember, and of course in the Choctaw way, above all, I want us to laugh. I want us to enjoy ourselves and to practice life in service to our people and a research world of our own making. I want us to be strong and aggressive and tough and resilient and full of feeling. I want us to be everything that's us, everything that's the deep at the center of our being. Each and every one of us has a responsibility now to recognize that power, to address the trauma of health inequities in our communities. A white friend of mine once said, "I feel so helpless." Well, I turned to her and I said, "I cannot afford that privilege. I give up hope, I die. That is a privilege I do not want, nor can we collectively afford." All of us are the health leaders we've been waiting for in partnership with our communities. We're the future of health equity research and wellness promotion, but we do stand on the great shoulders of great leaders and community elders and community knowledge. And when we lift our collective health in mind, body, spirit, and society, we will truly address the health equity for our future generations. Our time is to act now. So I just want us to reflect today. What kind of ancestor did your ancestor envision you to be? What kind of ancestor do you want to be? What kind of ancestor, by your health work and practices and research, are you shaping for future generations? Martin Luther King once said, "I have a dream," right? But our ancestors said, "I am dreaming you." So what kind of ancestor do we want to dream ourselves to be? So in closing, I want to share one little story. Long time ago, back in the day, when human beings, animals, the four-leggeds, the birds, everybody lived together, it was dark. Everyone was in cocoons, and they were all bumping into each other once they busted out of their cocoons because it was so dark and it was so frustrating. They were all getting so frustrated, bumping into each other, and they said, "We need light. We need fire. We need some kind of light." And so one of the animals said, "Oh, I know where there's some fire. It's in the east. But there's some really mean, greedy people guarding that fire. I don't know. We're going to have to go steal it to get it." And everyone said, "Well, let's have a grand council to figure out who can go get it for us." And so they had this big grand council. And this little grandmother spider, she's just this big, and she goes, I can help. "Grandmother spider, what are you doing?" Possum stood up. Possum said, "Oh, we're the ones to do this business. I know how to get that fire." He says, "Because we are the most beautiful animals around. We have gorgeous tails." Back in those days, possum's tail was very fluffy. And possum said, "I've got the plan. I'm going to go get it and wrap that ember up in my tail and come on back." And they're like, "Go ahead, possum, you try." So possum went walking over there and he grabbed that ember and he grabbed it in his tail and... Now you know what happened to possum's tail. So crow crow stands up and goes, "What is the matter with you people? Poor animals, you can't do it. Leave it to the bird people. We got this." And of course, crows should be the one to do it. Because crows, we are clever. We are beautiful singing voices. And back in those days, crows were white. And anyways, so the plan was, Crow said, "I'm going to fly over there, and I'm going to come up with a clever plan, and I'm probably going to sing them to distract it, and then I'll get an ember, and I'll come back." And they said, "Go ahead, Crow." So Crow's over there, and now he's over the fire, and he's standing over the fire, and he's so busy thinking, "How can I cleverly get this thing, and what song am I going to sing?" And before you know it, he's like, "Ah, ah, ah." He turned all black, and that's how we got Crow. Poor Crow. Well, Buzzard said, "Oh, you guys can't get this right either, because it's not about beauty, it's not about cunning, it is about speed." Buzzard said, "I can fly way up to the high parts of the sky, and I'm going to dive down and get that. And I'll get it, and I'll grab it on my head, and I'll come back." Because back then, Buzzard had lots of feathers. And sure enough, that's what he did. He went down, and he dove in, and he got that ember, and poor Buzzard, you know what happened to him. Meanwhile, the whole time, Grandmother Spider's going, "Guys, I can help. And, you know, no one's paying attention to little Grandmother Spider. And finally, after all of that fiasco, the Grand Council turned to Grandmother Spider and said, "Okay, go ahead. You want to give it a shot, Grandmother Spider? Let's show us what you can do." So Grandmother Spider said, "Okay." So she turned around and she started singing her song. She said her prayers. She took a little bit of clay from the earth and made a little tiny pot. And she put it on her back. And she threw out her beautiful web all the way to the east. And as she walked on that web, she sang her song. And she talked to the fire all the way while she's singing her song and said her prayers. And as she got there, she just took a little ember and put it in her pot, and she sang her song all the way back. And all of the council was like blown away. "Grandmother Spider, thank you for bringing fire to the people." And she said, "But our job is not done." She said, "Fire has two faces. It can hurt us or it can help us. So there's great responsibility to this fire. Who's going to step up and accept responsibility so that the fire continues and grows and that we all live? Who's going to take that responsibility?" And you know, that's the first time human beings spoke. And human beings stood up and said, "We'll do it. We'll take it, Grandmother Spider, if you teach us what we need to do to care for this fire." And so she did. She taught them the song. She taught the protocol. And she said, "Whenever you make your pottery, you always have to put a little piece of my symbol there. So you always remember that responsibility to that medicine. And as long as you take care of that medicine in a good way, it'll take care of you." And that's how fire came back to the people. So all of us are Grandmother Spider. So thank you.